Hello kids, Shubhamangalam, Eclectic Scholar, myself Sudeep. I'll be taking up class 9 physics for today. And the name of the chapter that we were discussing is motion. It's chapter number 2. We are on page number 16. In the previous video, at the end, we have studied about two formulae, which is, average speed and average velocity. Average speed is equal to total distance by total time taken. And average velocity is total displacement by total time taken. So we need to understand how do we measure average speed and average velocity by citing few examples over here. So for example, this is point A and this is point B. There are, you know, three people at point A and there are people at point B also. So now these three people from point A, they need to run and they need to reach point B. Do you understand? It's like a race, it's like a running race. So the people at point A need to run and they need to reach at point B. Do you understand? So point A is the starting point and point B is the destination point. At point B, those three people are standing there by with stopwatches in their hands. So that as soon as this person number one, runs and reaches one of the persons over there, that person is going to, end the stopwatch timer. Do you understand? Thereby recording the time. So why do we use a stopwatch to record the time? Yes or no? It was basically used in many sports matches wherever we see. So yes. So what are we going to do? There are three people over here who are going to run and run from point A and reach point B, which is the destination point. And at point B, there are judges who are holding the stopwatches in their hand. And as soon as somebody from point A reaches point B, they are going to end the stopwatch timer. Okay, and as soon as they start, they are going to start the stop clock, and once they reach, they are going to end the stop clock, thereby recording the time taken by those people to reach the respective positions. Do you understand? So now, for example, this is person number 1, 2 and 3. Okay, now how are they going to start? So the audience is going to clap all at once, and all these people started, running. As soon as the audience clapped, the people at point B, they started their stopwatch. Do you understand? So the time started recording now and these people started running. So these people, they ran and this person reached this point and this person reached this point and this person reached this point at, respective durations. For example, person 1 took 5 minutes. I hope this is like a 3-meter race. Okay, if this is a 3-meter race, the person 1 took 5 minutes, person 2 took 10 minutes, and person 3 took 12 minutes. So, how do you decide who is the winner of the race over here? Person 1, because he took the least time to reach the place, yes or no? But, did they follow a definite path? No, right? So what do you answer? What do you think? What is the path covered by them called as? The path covered by them is called as distance, because they did not follow a definite direction over here. They just wanted to reach the destination point and they ran however they could and they reached the destination point. As soon as they reached, the people who were holding the stopwatches, as soon as person 1 reached one person at point B, that person stopped his stop clock and recorded the time, and it was 5 minutes, and for person 2 it was 10, and person 3 it was 12 minutes. So how do you decide who ran the fastest? The distance is the same, the length of the path is the same, but people took different directions over here. Did you understand? They took different directions. They did not travel in one singular path or one singular straight line. So the path covered by them is considered to be distance. Do you understand? So here we can find out the average speed. What is the average speed? It is the total distance by time taken. 3 by 5, 3 by 10 and 3 by 12. Something like that. Let's make this number as 30 meters or something. It will become easier. So 30 by 5 is how much? 30 by 5, 30 by 10 and 30 by 12. 30 by 5 is 6. meters per minute. This is 3 meters per minute and this is 12 2 point something. So who ran with the fastest average over here? It was person 1 who ran with the fastest average. He was very smart. He was faster. He was running with the fastest average speed, and he had an average speed of about 6 meters per minute. He was able to run about 6 meters in a minute. It was just hypothetical. Okay, so now, so what did I say over here? what can you calculate? You can calculate the average speed, and the formula for average speed is going to be total distance by time taken. So for let's consider person 1. What was the total distance over here? It was 30 meters for everybody. But the time taken by person 1 is how much over here? 5 minutes. Do you understand? And respectively, the time taken for 2 and 3 is 10 and 12. That is why their average speed is also differentiating, and it is also different from the others. Do you understand? Someone with the highest average speed ran the fastest. Do you understand? Someone with the highest average speed ran the fastest. Someone with the lowest time taken is going to be the winner of the race. Who is the person who has taken the lowest time over here? Person 1. Can I calculate velocity in this case? What is the formula of velocity? It is average displacement by time taken. What is the definition of displacement? Displacement means when you are undergoing a path or traveling a path in a definite direction. Did these three guys over here use a definite direction and a definite path over here? No. So I can calculate only average speed over here because they have covered a certain distance. Do you understand? The distance between this point and this point was only 30 meters. Whatever path you take. Okay, so that is what is given in the question also over here in your textbook. That, you know, on page number 16, that those people, the distance between point A and point B is a definite distance. But it all depends that, you know, in what direction you are taking. Do you understand? This guy took a shortcut, maybe. And he reached the closest person possible. That is why. And he also ran very fast. It depends upon his running skills also. But he has not followed a definite path that was given to him. There was no definite path given to him. So this cannot be considered as displacement. It is considered as distance. That is why we were able to find just the average speed and not the average velocity. When can you find out the average velocity? You can find out the average velocity when displacement has happened. When all three of them are moving in a definite path and they are reaching point B. For example, if it was a completely different scenario over here and all these three persons over here are given three definite paths. Okay, there are three people at point A and point B. Point 1, person number 1 needs to travel in that path only. At point 2, person 2 needs to travel in that path. At point 3, the person needs to travel at that path. Okay. So now, person 1, 2, and 3 need to follow those straight lines and they need to reach only those respective people over here. So for example, person 1 and the distance is 30 meters. Person 1 completed it in 10 minutes. Person 2 completed it in 8 minutes. Person 3 completed it in 15 minutes. Okay, and what was the constant distance over here? It was 30. So how can I find out velocity over here? Why do I consider velocity now? Why am I telling velocity? Because they are going in a certain direction. And what is the formula for velocity? Displacement by time. What does displacement mean? Traveling a path, traveling a distance in a certain direction. So they have completed a certain distance in a certain direction. So average velocity is equal to displacement by time. What is the displacement over here? 30. And what was the time over here? Average velocity. V is equal to 30 by 10. Gives you how much? 3 meters per minute. And this is 30 by 8. How much class? 8 3s are 24, 8 4s are 32, 8 3, 3 point something. So this is 30 by 15. 15 1s are, 15 2s are. Whom do you think has taken the highest amount of time over here? Whom do you think has taken the highest amount of time? Okay, it is person number 3 who traveled the slowest. Did you understand? Because he took the highest amount of time to cover 30 meters. And person 2 covered 8 minutes. Do you understand? He took 8 minutes to cover 30 meters. So who was faster over here? Somebody is taking the least amount of time. Yes or no? So it was person number 2. So here, how much do I get? I get 2 meters per minute. And here I get 3 point something. So who has the highest average velocity over here? It is person 2 who is having the highest average velocity. 3 point some change. Okay, the other two have just 2 and 3. Now, person 2 has the highest average velocity. He took the least time, so he can be the winner over here because he traveled the exact path. This is how you calculate average velocity. You can calculate average velocity only when in the question it is mentioned that the people are traveling in a certain direction. Otherwise, you need to calculate average speed, which is distance by time, because in the question they might not mention whether they might not mention that those people were traveling in a certain direction. So to sum it up, average speed and average velocity. The first case was average speed because they were not given proper paths. Okay, the distance between A and B is 30 meters. Okay, maybe it is a square or something, that path, that the entire fencing is just a square fence, that you know, whatever direction you might take, maybe the distance is always going to be constant. There can be hypothetical situations over here. Of course, you can consider individual distances also. You can consider that person 1 traveled 25 meters, person B, person 2 traveled 30 meters, person C traveled 35 meters. If they are not following a definite path, the distances might also change. Of course, if the distances change, then the time duration will also change, and then you can definitely calculate the average speed over here. But in the second case, they are given definite paths. So all of them are traveling the same distance over here. It is 30 meters. So when you're traveling a proper path in the same distance, the same path, the same track, and you are taking different times, then you can decide who's the winner. Do you understand? And in this case, you are going to calculate average velocity. The first case tells me about average speed where the direction was not decided. The length is definitely decided. The length or distance between A and B, or you know, how much space is there between A and B is already decided. But in case number 1, person 1, 2 and 3 took different paths. So it all depends on then how many meters did they cross. Okay, it is not always same. The sides of the square might be equal, but the diagonals are never going to be, you know, the same as that of the square. Yes or no? So, you know, for example, if it was case number one, then person 1, 2 and 3, if 1 traveled from here and then reached this, so instead of traveling 30 meters, there is a possibility he traveled 32 or 35 meters. In how many minutes? In 5 minutes. There is a possibility. And person 2, he traveled to this particular person, maybe he traveled only 20 meters because he took a shortcut, but he took lots of time. It's like 10 minutes or something. The same thing can happen with third person 3. So why is this all, you know, being created over here? Because in case number 1, these guys were not given definite paths. Okay, usually in running tracks and all, you are given a definite path and you cannot run in some other's track, somebody else's track. Of course, you can run in somebody else's track when there is no other person there along with you. Of course, you can do that. But there is somebody running along with you, you cannot, you know, intrude into their tracks. So possibly over here, like marathons and all. Okay, in marathons and all, you can actually intrude other's tracks because you're doing it only for an awareness program. But when it is like a state level game or a national level game, you cannot intrude in anybody else's path if they are also running along with you. Okay, you cannot intrude in anybody else's path. So the case 1 was just a hypothetical case where you are trying to explain, when I'm trying to explain you what is average speed. It is distance by time. Why do we consider distance? Because they don't have a definite path. Okay, and from case number 1, who was the fastest? Person 1 was the fastest. So, in case number 2, when they are given proper paths and they were running and they were taking their own sweet time over there, then what did you understand? Who was the fastest? That is person 2 who was the fastest. This is a clear example of what should be considered during, you know, track races. You need to consider the average velocity because you're running in a proper track, in a proper path. Okay, so the next part over here is instantaneous speed. So while you are driving in traffic, and as soon as the traffic releases and you are the only one, you are at the first line of all the cars and you must be feeling, having a heroic feeling, and you are like, okay, I'm going to speed up my car now. So the acceleration or the speed happening at a certain instant is called as instantaneous speed. As soon as you accelerate your car and you are like driving with a larger speed, then that kind of speed is called as instantaneous speed. Basically, the speed at given at any instant, the speed recorded at any instant. And how do you record the speed? Are you going to note it down with a paper and a pen? No, there is a speedometer in every vehicle which is going to tell you at what speed is your vehicle running. okay, it is not going to run on its own, you are the one who is going to run. So the speedometer is going to tell you at what speed is the automobile running, and of course you need to drive at a steady speed and not very very fast, because it's really dangerous. So that was just an example that we were referring, like if you are at the first line and you feel like driving very fast because there is a whole army of cars behind you and whole army of vehicles behind you, and they you know, it's like a kind of a fast and furious feeling, but don't do that. Of course, it is not advisable at all. Never drive. You are not eligible to drive. So now we have, what was I discussing? Yes, we were discussing about instantaneous speed. Speed at any instant is called as instantaneous speed. What do you mean by instant? At any moment. Do you understand? At any moment, if there is a certain amount of speed happening, then that is called as instantaneous speed. So for example, if we had to, you know, we have an example problem over here. We have an example on page number 17, okay, where they are plotting a graph, where they are plotting a graph, and they are giving us three different distances at three different times, and they are asking us what is T3. In think and discuss portion, we have you know, calculated how to calculate the average speed. We subtracted the odometer readings, and that particular answer was divided by the number of hours. It was 700 by 25, yes, and we got the answer as 28 kilometers per hour. But here we have something else. Okay, they have given us certain distances and certain time readings over here, and they're asking us to find out the time at instant T3. Okay, and T3 is between T1 and T2 over here. So T3 is considered only to S3 over here. When we want to find out the, you know, average speed, or, you know, when we want to find out the average speed at the instant T3, we need to subtract S2 minus F1 and divide it by T2 minus T1 to find out the instantaneous average speed at T3. Okay, this is not as needed as that. So I will read the question for you. What is the speed of the car at the instant of time 3 for given motion? We know how to find the average speed during the time interval T1 to T2, which includes the instant T3. Yes, you know, if you look at the graph, you can see that T3 is included between T1 and T2 over here. I will draw it up on the board. Then I'm just reading it out for you now. Average speed is equal to S2 minus S1 by T2 minus T1. We calculate average speed for a very short interval encompassing the time at an instant T3. This interval is so short interval that the value of average speed would not change materially if it was made even shorter. The instantaneous speed is represented by the slope of the curve at a given instant of time. Can you see the graph over here, and there is a slope over here? The larger the slope, the higher was the speed at that instant. Do you understand? If this slope was much bigger, this means that person traveled at that particular instant time 3, T3, very very fast. Do you understand? And he covered a lot of distance also. If you're driving at a very fast speed, of course you're covering a larger amount of distance. So the larger the slope, the higher the speed. The slope of this curve, the instantaneous speed is represented by the slope of the curve at a given instant of time. The slope of the curve gives the speed of the car at any instant. So if the slope is large, the speed is high. If the slope is small, the speed is low. Okay, speed gives us the idea of how fast the body moves. Fine. Now, why are we talking about speed? Because we were not knowing which direction was the person taking. So if I wanted to draw that particular graph that is given in your textbook over here, and I want to find out what is the time at instant T3, okay, what is the average speed at instant T3, then I need to subtract S2 minus S1 by T2 minus T1. Okay, because T3 is encompassed between T1 and T2, and S3 is encompassed between, you know, S1 and S3, S1 and S2. Yes, there we go. So here we have S1, S2 and S3. Okay, and here I have T1, T3 and T2. Okay, so here you can see that the slope is taking a big level high up, and I draw a tangent to it. Okay, just one tangent is enough. So here, okay, so T1 is corresponding to S1, S2 is corresponding to T2, and T3 is encompassed between S3. So they have asked us to find out what is the instantaneous speed at T3. So T3 is encompassed or, you know, a part of both T1 and T2 over here. So what are you going to do? You're going to find out the average speed distance by time, which is S2 minus S1 by T2 minus T1. Okay, it is just, you know, a hypothetical formula given over here, which will not be used in any of the problems. But what you need to understand from the graph is, like at T3, you can see the slope going a level up. So what does this slope going at a level up signify? It shows that at this particular instant, the driver accelerated the speed of the car and he covered a lot of amount of distance. Okay, and the speed was very, very high. A larger slope is going to signify that the automobile was driving at a very high speed. Okay, at very large speed. If the slope takes a dip over here, okay, if it was reverse and it was taking a dip, this means the car was moving at a very slow speed. So to find out the speed at instant T3, you need to use the formula of average speed, which is nothing but distance by time, and here you need to subtract the distances S2 minus S1, because S3 is a part of S2 minus S1 over here, and the corresponding time is T3. So you need to subtract the time over here, which is T2 minus T1, okay, because T3 is a part of T1 and T2. Do you understand? So it is basically from point A to point B, when a person was trying to reach point B, at some instant between, he tried to increase his speed. Do you understand? To find out the speed, to find out the average speed at that instant, you're going to subtract the two endpoints, which are the start point and the end point. Usually, what do we do? If we remember the Sirpur, Kagas Nagar station and Hyderabad example on page number 15. On page number 15, we have Sirpur, Kagas Nagar example in Hyderabad. The train is traveling from Sirpur, Kagas Nagar to Hyderabad, and they asked us to find out the average distances. What did I tell you over here? For every hour, you need to find out how many kilometers did that train travel. Okay. And you are going to sum all those values, like 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. You remember we drew it on the board. You can refer the previous video. For every hour, you need to sum up how many kilometers did the train cover. And you're going to divide by the number of hours taken for the entire journey, which was 6 hours. Do you understand? This is how you find out the average speed of the entire journey. But here they are asking us to find out the average speed at an instant. And what is that instant over here? T3. And T3 is between T1 and T2. So you cannot add up T1 plus T3 and T2 over here. You need to subtract the starting point and the end point, the starting distance and the end distance, and the starting time and the end time. Or because the end time is going to be definitely larger than the starting time, it is going to be T2 minus T1. And the end distance is going to be larger than the starting distance, it needs to be S2 minus S1. So they are not asking you average speed of the entire journey. They are asking you to, you know, find out the average speed at a certain instant. If it was the entire journey, it would be S1 plus S2 plus S3 divided by T1 plus T2 plus T3. Do you understand? But they are not asking us to find out the average speed of the entire journey. They are only asking us at an instant. And the instant is a part of a certain time duration, which is T2 minus T1, and that instantaneous distance or instantaneous, you know, speed is a part of a certain distance duration, which is S2 minus S1. Hope you understood this. So the further one, okay, observing the direction of the motion of a body. If I take a stone and I tie a thread to it and I whirl it, okay, if I am, you know, playing with the stone and I am whirling the stone, and if I am doing it like this, I'm whirling it down so that, you know, the thread is in my hand and the stone is down over here and I'm whirling it with full force. Okay, when I'm whirling it, suddenly I release it. I release the thread and the stone falls down. You see, the stone is taking the circular path, or is it going in a straight line path? It takes a straight line path. Do you understand? For example, if this was the stone, okay, and I am whirling it in circular motion. After whirling it for certain times, I leave the stone and the stone falls down and, you know, rolls in a certain direction. Okay, I again do it, and this time I drop it somewhere else, and then it is taking another direction over here. So you see, when you drop the stone, it is taking a line wise direction. It is just moving in a certain direction, which is in a line. It is not rolling and falling down also. Okay, it is not creating a hole on the ground and rolling and falling down. Okay, it is not in a whirlpool motion down. So when you throw the stone down or when you release the stone down, it takes a tangent direction. For example, okay, if this was the circular motion and I throw the stone down somewhere at this point, then the stone is going to fall and roll in this direction. Do you understand? Now, if I throw the stone at this particular point, okay, if I throw the whirling stone at this particular point, it is going to move in this direction. It is not going to go here and here and come back again in this direction or move in a circular motion. Does it happen on its own like that? No. As soon as you release the stone, it is going to cover a certain amount of distance in a line. Okay, so if I drop the stone at this particular point, it is going to cover this particular distance. So what are these lines to a circle over here? These are nothing but tangents. Tangents drawn to a circle are representing the vectors. Okay, it is representing the vectors of the circle over here. What do you mean by this? It is representing in which direction the stone is covering a certain distance. Do you understand? In which direction the stone is covering a certain distance. What was I doing? I was whirling a stone and I dropped it at a certain point. When I dropped it at a certain point, did the stone take a curve and started moving in a circular direction? No, it did not start moving in a certain direction. It just moved to a certain distance in a line and then stopped. Okay, again I am whirling the stone and dropping at a particular point over here. When I whirl the stone and drop it in a particular point, is it again going to go in a curved path? No, it is going in a straight line path and then stopping. Similarly, I have done this on the other end also, at the other point also. So I draw these lines. These lines represent as tangents to a circle. Okay. Tangent is any line which is touching the circle at a certain point. So what do these lines represent over here? Tangents to a circle. What do these tangents represent? The tangents represent vectors. What are these vectors representing? They are representing the direction in which the stone was traveling after falling down. Do you understand? They represent the direction in which the stone was traveling after falling down. Okay, so now that was the observing the direction of motion of a body. Understanding uniform and non-uniform motion. We will study further about this curvilinear or the circular motion vectors. Before that, we need to understand what is uniform and what is non-uniform motion. Okay, so we have studied about uniform and non-uniform motion in our previous classes also, which were very simple to understand. But right now, let's take an example of a cyclist. Okay, let's take an example of a cyclist. We have a table over here that we can refer. Come to page number 19, page number 19. And they have given us a table where the time instance and the distance covered is mentioned. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 and 0, 4, 8, 12 and 16. Okay, so this distance is in meters and time is in seconds. So let's look at the question over here, class. Page number 19, activity number 5. Understanding uniform motion. Consider a cyclist moving on a straight road. Okay. Understand, they have given you straight road examples. The distance covered by him with respect to time is given in the following table. Draw the distance versus time graph. So when you have to draw the distance versus time graph, you need to make sure that on the x-axis you are going to have time and on the y-axis you are going to have the distance, which is going to be represented by what? S. Okay, so at the 0th second, this is second, okay, this is time. So at the 0th second, now no distance was covered. 0 meters covered by the cyclist. At the first second, he covered 4 meters. At the second second, he covered 8 meters. At the third second, he covered 12 meters. At the fourth second, he covered 16 meters. Now look at these numbers very carefully. If you are like, you know, noticing it. If you are looking at these numbers carefully, can you find out the difference between the consecutive numbers over here? 4 minus 0 is how much, class? 4. 8 minus 4 is how much? 4. 12 minus 8 is how much? 4 again. 16 minus 12 is how much? 4. Do you see a consistency over here? This means at every second he was covering 4 meters. Yes or no? So what do you understand by this? A motion happening at, you know, regular intervals of time and covering equal distances in that time period will be called as uniform motion. You have a perfect definition over here. The motion of the body is said to be uniform when the velocity is constant. Okay, now how do you find out the velocity over here? Why do I consider velocity and not speed? Remember in the question they specified the cyclist is running or moving his cycle or running on the cycle. The cyclist is traveling on a straight road. Okay, they have mentioned the word straight. This means the direction is already prior given. That is why I am considering velocity, because the formula of velocity is displacement by time, and displacement is nothing but distance happening in a certain direction. So now, this is the distance which is happening in a certain direction. In the first second, he covered 4 meters. In the second second, he covers 8 meters. In the third second, he covers 12 meters. In the fourth second, he's covering 16 meters class. So when I take the difference of the, you know, upper one, okay, if I take the distance between two consecutive measurements over here, we understand, what do we understand? We understand that it is completely consistent. Okay, what do we understand? We get a consistent number over here, which is 4. Okay, so this means he was going in a consistent motion. He was covering a consistent speed. Do you understand? In regular time intervals given over here, he was covering a consistent amount of distance. Okay, for every second, he was covering 4 meters of distance. For example, if I want to plot the graph, and this is the origin. This is 1. This, okay, let's take 2. 4, 8, okay, the time period is given as 1, 2, 3, right? So, the time period here can be written as 1, 2, 3, and 4. And on y-axis, you can take one block as, you know, 1 centimeter as 2 units. And if I consider 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. Till there we'll take, because there's no more space. So for the first second, how much did he travel? He traveled 4 meters. For the second second, how much did he travel? He traveled 8 meters. For the third second, he traveled 12 meters. So when I join these points, what do I get? I get a straight line. So what does the straight line in a distance versus time graph represent? It represents that the body was moving in a straight line motion. Remember the graphs of motion that we studied in class 8, the last chapter. It clearly says that, you know, whenever the graph is giving you a straight line from the origin, this means the body was traveling in a uniform motion. So what do you mean by a body traveling in uniform motion? It is covering consistent amount of distances in regular time intervals. Did you understand? It is covering consistent amount of distances in regular time intervals. So now if I erase these distances over here, okay, and I take the next table. Fine. What is the next table? Because table number 3 on page number 19, and it is 0, 1, 4, 9, 16. Do you think this is consistent? Okay, what is the difference between 1 minus 0? It is 4 minus 1, it is 3. 9 minus 4, it is 5. 16 minus 9, how much class? 9 plus 7? 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. So yeah, it is 7. It is 1, 3, 5, 7. Of course, I understand it is prime numbers. But that doesn't mean that, you know, it is consecutive or it is uniform motion. It needs to be the same number on this end when you're dividing the superior number with its prior number. Okay, like if you're dividing the second number minus the first number, it should give you a certain figure. And if you're dividing the third number, I mean, if you're subtracting the third number with the second number, it should give you a figure which is the same as the first figure. Like the 4. Do you understand? For example, 1 minus 0 is 1 and 4 minus 1 is 3 and 5 and 7 respectively. Are these the same numbers over here? No. It should, like in the first example over here, we were having 4 for all of them. It was the same figure. It was the same number. Okay, it was the same number that happened. Because how much ever you subtract the second number with the first one, the third with the second one, the fourth with the third one, if you look at the pattern of those numbers which was given in the previous example, that is table number 2 on page number 19. The page number 19, table number 2, the distance measurement that is given over there is giving you a pattern of numbers which has the equal difference. Do you understand? This number does not have an equal difference over here. Okay, when you subtract the second with the first one and the third with the second one, you're getting two different numbers. So what does this show you? Like, try to plot the graph. Okay, so this is 0, the origin, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, or instead of that, you can take on y-axis the 1 centimeter to be 2 units. It can be 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, and 12. Fine, on at the first second, how much did he travel? 1. So 1 is going to come between 0 and 2. At the second second, how much did he travel? He traveled 4 meters. At the third second, how much did he travel? 9. The 9 is going to come between 8 and 10. We have done these graphs of motion earlier also. So it is something like this. So at the fourth second, he is going to come at 16, which is going to be somewhere over here. Okay, so is this a straight line motion over here? It is not a straight line motion. If the graph is not giving, if the distance versus time graph is not representing a straight line graph, then what does this mean? It means the body is undergoing a non-uniform motion. Okay, why do you call it non-uniform? Because the distances were not uniform. They were not having the equal differences. Do you understand? If it was 0, 4, 8, 12, and 16, the difference between the two numbers, the consecutive two numbers, is the same as the rest. But here, the difference is not the same. If it was 1, 1, 1, and 1, what do you think? Is it going to be uniform or non-uniform? It is going to be uniform. If it was 3, 3, 3, and 3, what is it going to be? It is going to be uniform again. But we have different set of numbers over here. Okay, we have different set of numbers. Don't indulge the mathematical notion over here. We have different set of numbers over here. These numbers are not the same. The differences of two consecutive numbers are not the same. This is also proving that the motion of the body is not uniform. Also, you can plot the graph. When we plot the graph, do we get a straight line? We don't get a straight line. So what does this prove? That the body is not undergoing uniform motion. It is undergoing non-uniform. So on page number 19, you are going to write on table number 2, uniform motion. And for table number 3, you are going to write above it that the body undergoes non-uniform motion. They have asked you to draw the distance versus time graph for table number 2 and 3. And that is the homework for today. Okay, so you are going to note down Sakshi, where I am going to mention that you need to draw the distance versus time graph for table 2 and table 3. Remember, the time should be taken on y-axis, and you can take 1 unit or 1 centimeter to be 1 unit, and you can take on x-axis distance. You have to take the y-axis as distance. Okay, let me see this. This is the x-axis. On x-axis, you need to consider time, and on the y-axis, you need to consider distance. I repeat, on the x-axis, you need to consider time. And the scale of the graph is going to be 1 centimeter, 1 unit. And this is y-axis. Sorry, this is x-axis. And on y-axis, you are going to consider 1 centimeter to be 2 units. Okay, this on x-axis, the 1 centimeter, 1 unit is going to represent the time. And on y-axis, 1 centimeter 2 units is going to represent the distance. Okay, I repeat again, on the x-axis it is time, and on the y-axis it is distance. X-axis the scale should be taken as 1 centimeter 1 unit. Y-axis you can take the scale as y-axis is 1 centimeter 2 units, and that is going to represent the distance. The y-axis represents the distance, the x-axis represents the time. That is why it is called as distance versus time graph. So you are going to note down Sakshi over here. Classwork, how many pages did we do today, class? It is from page number 16 to page number 19, which was completed. Page 16 to page 19, done. And homework, draw distance versus time graph for table 2 and 3 on page 19. I already drew the graph for you on the board. You can very well watch the video again and try to understand how to draw the graph. Remember to take on x-axis time and y-axis the distance. Okay, so why do we take on distance on y-axis? Because distance is a varying factor. The time cannot be varying. Okay, you're going to take the time as 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, or 0, 2, 4, 6, and 8, so on. So time is an independent variable, whereas, you know, distance is a dependent variable. That is why you take it on y-axis. So for now, just try to understand. On the x-axis, you're going to take time, and on the y-axis, you're going to take distance, and you're going to draw the graphs for distance versus time graphs for table number 2 and table number 3 on page number 19. Hope you're clear. Please give it a reading. The rest of it we will do in the next video. Thank you for now.